Great. Well, it's lovely to be here. It's been a long time since I've been down this way in Virginia, and it just was a reminder of how gorgeous it is, so I have to make an effort to come down. I've been doing work with problem gambling for a little over 30 years. I started when I was 5, of course. But back when I started, there were 2 programs in the country that addressed the issue of problem gambling. There was the program where I was at the Veterans Administration Medical Center in Cleveland, Ohio, or Brecksville, which is the suburb. So that's where I started out and worked for about 18 years of my career. And there was a program in Maryland at Taylor Manor. That was it. And I did my internship at the VA's program, and I was forced to do it. I had no interest in addiction, no interest in gambling, you know, protested, tried to get out of it, but they made me do it. And it was fun. It was lovely. I ended up torturing gamblers for my dissertation on attention deficits among pathological gamblers, but I never thought I'd get a job because there weren't any jobs in the field. And my supervisor, the person who'd been my supervisor with the gambling program, left to go out to Reno, Nevada. The social worker who took it over after him went into private practice, and the head of psychology asked if I would come in at least temporarily take over the program because he knew I had promised that I would never work at the VA. So watch out what you promise yourself. So I came back, and it was so enjoyable that I said, well, you know, I said I would never work here, but could I do this, you know, permanently? You know, and the clouds parted, the universe said yes, and I've been doing it ever since. You know, certainly back in those days, if you wanted to gamble at a casino and you lived in Ohio, you had to travel days and days in your car to get to Las Vegas. You know, there wasn't even Atlantic City back in those days. And since then, you know, gambling has just sprouted like weeds across the country. And Virginia is a rarity to that extent. And we'll talk a little bit about that. So before I get into this, let me ask you, did you come here with any questions or topics you really wanted to hear something about in the area of problem gambling this morning?
I'm eager to hear, compare and contrast issues in problem gambling and substance abuse, alcoholism, particularly brain stuff.
Okay. Well, I'll be sure to touch on that a little bit.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's like a whole other day's presentation, yeah. But yeah, good question. Yes.
Well, I'm noticing now, you know, I'm old, so when I was young, the same thing with gambling, it wasn't a big issue, we didn't have the lottery tickets and things like that, but what I notice now, and I teach as opposed to doing private practice, and the kids are, it's another process addiction with a and, you know, it's like, I don't allow them to do that, and I explain that you need to get to an older state when you get bored, but you have to learn to do it on your own. I see underneath this need to escape, which gambling is a process addiction, this, when we take that away, I mean, is it just kind of covering up anxiety, or what are we going to replace it with? Because if they're really, I think, almost rewiring your brain. Because if they can't do this, they get severely depressed and anxious.
Yes.
I mean,
yes.
People don't seem to realize how screwed up we're becoming because we don't know how to daydream, but we don't have windows. They said when I was bored, like you were, I looked out the window and daydreamed or wrote stories. But we didn't have any even windows in my classroom.
Yeah, I mean, with kids, it's really interesting, and we'll talk a bit about that and the higher rates of gambling issues among kids. But then you have the video gaming and the internet and the social games and gambling and all that kind of stuff. Absolutely. And we're just beginning to explore that and learn what it does to kids' brains who are so much more vulnerable than adult brains in many ways and not providing the alternative. get on my soap. I mean, when I was a kid, my mom kicked me out of the house in the morning and didn't really want me back till dinner time. Now parents get arrested if they do that with kids. So kids don't know how to play independently, don't know how to respond without the structure. And I think we really have to question the kinds of environments we're creating and raising our kids in, and, you know, the technology and the impact. We're not going to go back, but how are we going to move forward with some sanity? Really important questions, yeah. Was there a question? Yeah.
Well, along with what Jenna was asking, I'm quite interested in gambling and the sex addiction and the prevalence.
Yeah, sexual addiction, substance use addictions, other process addictions, shopping, eating disorders, all part of the same package in many ways. Great. Any other topics or areas that people wanted to address? Great. Well, what my overview was we'll talk about the terms and defining some terms around gambling, talk about why bother addressing the issue of gambling in substance use settings and mental health settings, in primary care settings, in schools, why bother? And the title of the presentation was Have the Conversation. And I don't know if you're aware of this, probably not, but March was and is every year Problem Gambling Awareness Month. So next March, pay attention. Look it up online, find out what's going on, ask your neighbors. But the theme this year that I really liked was Have the Conversation. And it's something I've been talking about for a lot of years, that we need to make this a topic of conversation, particularly among high-risk populations, with folks with other addictive and mental health disorders certainly are. And look at what are some current practices, and how do you even ask the questions? How do you open up the conversation with clients, with your neighbors, with people you ride the bus with, whoever. And this is the Maryland Center. We're fairly new. We're in the third year of operation. And I've been with the center for the past year. I was in Connecticut for a few years before that, and then Ohio for the rest of my life. But we do everything around problem gambling within the state of Maryland. I think the state Department of Health and Mental Hygiene, when they were opening the casinos and they're taxing the casinos to pay for problem gambling services, says, what in the world are we going to do with this? And nobody wanted it, so they gave it to the university. So in case something gets wrong, you know, we're the ones you can blame for that. So that's my role, is to be, you know, the person to blame if anything goes wrong around problem gambling. Now, I apologize. These three slides are not in your handouts. It's my fault. I found them last night looking online, so I went online and just out of curiosity said, gambling in Virginia. So you can find this if you go look in, you know, Google gambling in Virginia. So you have the nice picture of the woman who still has her money. That's probably before she went gambling. If you're traveling to Virginia anytime soon and we're thinking of taking in a casino during your stay, you'll be sadly disappointed. There's only one place in the entire state where you can gamble, at the Racino, and that was a word that didn't exist 30 years ago. That's a new word in our vocabulary. Represents the only place in the area. So gambling in Virginia is very limited, which makes us sad. You can take part in it on the track as well as off-track betting, daily simulcasting. You can find poker tournaments and other games. Here's the trick. The games are free to enter, meaning that there's no need for the state legislature to get involved. Isn't that a lovely thing? Yes.
I just wanted to say about visible gambling versus the invisible gambling.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Very big.
What?
Numbers.
Numbers.
Very good.
The lottery, house games.
Bingo.
Bingo, charitable gaming. Now, are your bingo halls here, do they have machines that look like slot machines? Do you know? No, none of them?
Some of them have computers that you rent when you get there instead of buying the paper.
Okay, yeah, because I found out that bingo halls today are not necessarily my grandmother's bingo halls. In Maryland, they look like little mini casinos often, so you have to ask, what are you talking about?
Colonial Downs closed a few years ago.
Did it?
Yeah.
Well, what do you have now?
Nothing.
Nothing?
Go to Charlestown.
No racino, just the surrounding?
Some of the off-track centers are still open, but they're not doing races at Colonial Downs, although they're trying to open it up again in September.
With simulcasting and live racing?
That's what the off-track centers do, yes.
Okay.
One of those in Hampton.
Okay, so you have off-track, but is there tart playing or anything at the off-track?
I've never been there.
Where's the gambler here? Interesting. But I think the bottom line of this is you can go elsewhere, but remember, there's a convenient way to gamble. All you need is your computer or your cell phone.
Or you take a bus up to Dover.
Yeah, you know, or wherever. But, you know, I thought the point of this is, you know, if you get a little bored, directing you to this online gambling site was the point of this. And, you know, it's really interesting. When I first started, of course, it was so rare to go to any area that had casinos. Now it's so rare to go to an area that doesn't have a casino within 1 or 2 hours of everybody in the state. So you must be doing something right.
There are regular bus trips every weekend from Virginia Beach and other cities. You can go to Atlantic City. It costs $20 and they give you $20 worth of tickets when you get there.
Yes.
For the slot machines.
Absolutely. Before the casinos opened in Ohio, I had an uncle who's a World War II veteran and he loved playing poker, so he'd get on the bus twice a week to go to the casinos in New York at that time. Yeah. Yes.
Well, it was interesting. I moved to Iowa in the early 80s and they were a very prim and proper state and, you know, no gambling or anything. And then they ran into the farm crisis in the mid 80s, so they introduced the gambling. And it is so odd how the marketing, you know, you would be a pariah if you were just in gambling. And then they made it like gambling going was your patriotic duty because it supported the schools. So they totally, even on TV, you know, you could do it at home, the lottery or something. And I worked in addiction in Iowa, and at that same time, you know, the methamphetamine epidemic began. And I'll tell you, it's a mess. And I saw what they did to those people, especially the poor people, because that was the only way they had a dream, and they pushed it, like by gambling, you were doing your patriotic duty.
Sure.
And it's just so terrible. Because it was the poor people statistically that couldn't afford to that are buying the lottery tickets and really getting in trouble.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we have gambling. You know, this says what percentage of adults have gambled either in the past year or in their lifetime. So what percentage of adults do you think have gambled?
95%.
90%. So it's very normalized now. People do it, you know, the lottery. How many people have, you know, a 401k retirement plan? We're gambling, you know, we're gambling with that. So 90% of folks gamble. Ta-da! And what is gambling? You know, if you bet on a horse, well, that's gambling. If you bet you can make 3 spades, that's just recreation and leisure. If you bet cotton will go up, that's business. If you play bingo at your church, that's charity. And people don't necessarily understand what I'm talking about when I ask, you know, have you ever gambled? Many people will say no. And then I'll say, well, when did you buy your last lottery ticket? Well, on my way to your office. Yeah, one lovely young counselor, we were doing a training during the break, comes up to us and said, you know, when you said bingo was gambling, I didn't hear what you said for the next hour. My grandmother goes to bingo several times a week. I never thought of it as gambling. And, you know, so when we ask clients or people or community samples, do you gamble? And they'll say no, because many people just think in terms of the casino or playing poker or betting on horses, but they don't think of all these other activities necessarily as what you're talking about. So gambling is any activity or game where you risk something of value, whether money or not. On an activity or game that has an uncertain outcome. So there's that element of uncertainty and risking something of value. So for adults, that's often money, but what can adults also risk that's of value? Yeah.
Well, you can risk your car title.
Your car title, your home, and casinos will take both. They don't talk about it, they may deny it, but they will take car titles and they will take home titles. So oftentimes counselors have said, well, you know, if you think you have a problem and you want to limit your gambling, you know, just leave your credit card in the car. If somebody has a gambling problem, you know, it's nothing to go back to the car to get the credit card, and in the meantime, they'll get the title to the car as well. What do kids gamble?
Say that again.
What do kids or adolescents gamble with?
Possessions.
Possessions. How many people have teenagers? How many cell phones have your teenagers lost? That's kind of normal, so you don't even think of, oh, I lost my cell phone again. Well, maybe you did lose it. Oh, I lent my Xbox controller to my buddy and they busted it. I need another Xbox controller. Yeah.
Back in the 50s, we used to gamble by pitching pennies.
Absolutely.
Marbles.
Marbles.
Baseball cards.
Yes.
All those are possessions.
Cards, yeah. All. We were working with one group of kids, and we asked that question. We said, well, we gamble homework. If I lose, I have to do your homework for a week. You know, candy, lunch. I'll give you my lunch. I'll trade you my dessert. Anything and everything, clothing. So people, relationships for adults. You know, I'm gambling that I'll be able to keep this relationship. Time is really a valuable commodity. So even if I have lots of money, but I'm spending too much time, on one supervision call last week, counselors were talking about folks coming in for fantasy sports. You know, you used to get your fantasy team and you'd play with that team for the whole season, and maybe there was a little entry fee or something. Now it's daily, game by game. You can change teams, you have multiple games, you pay an entry fee. They don't really consider it gambling because FanDuel and these other agencies, Sport Kings, aren't doing wagering, but you pay a fee to enter a league, to buy a team, and you win a whole bunch of money theoretically at the end. Now there are folks getting multiple teams and spending hours and hours and hours engaged in selecting new teams every day. So this one guy came into treatment because his wife was just fed up with the amount of time particularly he was spending on this, but as well as the money was adding up for joining multiple leagues. So it's right on that cusp. Is this gambling or not? Well, to me, it sounds a whole lot like gambling. Technically, you can avoid being categorized that way and regulated. So lots of new ways. So how many adults in Virginia are likely to have a gambling problem? What are the percentage of adults that you think would have a gambling problem? 10%? Good guess. Probably a little on the high side, at least according to the research. That's more like the number of people who have an alcohol disorder. Other ideas? 30%? That's a little on the high side.
7 or 8.
That's only if you talk to the people who are at the casino. Probably about 30% of those folks have a gambling problem. It's probably, if you just use diagnostic criteria, you usually get about 1-1.5%. If you include something comparable to substance abuse, you get about 3%. In Maryland, it's 3.4%. So if we, and Virginia has not studied this issue at all. We don't know. But if we apply those national and Maryland numbers, this is Raven Stadium, holds about 71,000 folks. So if you filled it up three times, be a little bit less than the estimated number of adults in Virginia who have some level of gambling problem. How many folks do you think are getting any kind of treatment? Zero, or maybe a few of these folks standing on the sideline here are getting any kind of help. One of the issues and one of the differences in substance use disorders, we have a legal system that funnels people into treatment for substance use, not the same for gambling. You know, you don't have the DUI stream, you don't have the other streams, public. You know, the only people who get identified are those who might get caught for embezzlement. And that's the very, very highest tip of the iceberg. So, you know, the legal system, so people have to really be self-identified as I have a problem and I need help for this problem, and no mandate for being in treatment. So even if they ask for help, they're very prickly and it's really hard to keep people in treatment for a gambling disorder for a variety of reasons. And then we have the kids and all the ways that kids can gamble. And this is not a new problem. Kids have been tossing pennies and playing dice on street corners for a lot of years. But what is new is the poker craze. A few years back, chips and decks of cards were one of the favorite Christmas presents for 10 and 11-year-olds. So not even adolescents, the pre-adolescents, and kids are likely to start gambling. Where? Where do kids first have their gambling experience? At home, with their parents. They play cards, you know, for pennies or matchsticks or something, or play bingo games at home, or some other kind of activity. My first gambling experience was I was a spoiled little kid, and when my parents had their friends over, they let me stay up and sit in on the poker game. And I felt so cool and so adult at age 7, learning how to play this adult game, you know. So I think we've all had those kinds of experiences. My uncle took me to the racetrack and let me put the $2 on a horse. You know, I liked the name, so let me, yeah. So my biggest win was about $3. That's the limit of my big win. But all sorts of ways that kids are playing, and the parents think this is great. They're just playing poker in the basement. They're not drinking or doing drugs. Now, if you ask the kids, how much are you betting? The kids will say, well, you know, we had, you know, $100 or so riding on this game. The parents think it's pennies. So the parents may not know the kind of wagering that's going on. And Chuck E. Cheese, one parent sued Chuck E. Cheese for teaching her kids to gamble. Of course, it got settled, but. So if adults have 1-3%, kids and youth have 2-3 times that level, and that's pretty consistent around the world. We're still not sure whether or not that's a generation that's being raised with normalized gambling, or it's just part of what youth do. They drink more, they experiment, they try all sorts of things, and it'll level off as they get old. So we haven't really followed youth into adulthood to see what kind of behaviors persist. So in Virginia, we would estimate 75,000 to over 100,000 kids who may have some issues around gambling. And we see even fewer kids coming into treatment because parents can control the resources more. And they don't perceive of it as a significant problem that they need help with. So we talked about gambling. Gambling disorder is the current diagnostic terminology, newest DSM-5. Used to be called pathological gambling, a little bit harsher sounding. And problem gambling, we look at it, again, as comparable to substance use disorder, not quite meeting the cutoff criteria for having a gambling disorder diagnosis, but it's never been an official diagnostic category like substance abuse was, and we'll look at the importance of that soon. This at-risk category is really interesting when you start looking at things like health problems, medical problems, treatment costs, how you can look at co-occurring issues. And this group seems to keep popping up again and again in terms of other at-risk types of behaviors and conditions. Recreational gambler is a term to use for somebody who gambles without any kind of problems in their life. They're not losing control. They're not having negative consequences. It's like social drinking. I know when to cut it off. I don't exceed my limits. It's not interfering in my life. And that's certainly the majority of people can gamble recreationally, just like the majority of people can drink socially without major problems.
Excuse me. Are people experience depression at greater risk of gambling because you get that high?
Yes.
And that's one way to self-medicate?
Yeah. You know, anybody with a mental health disorder, whether it's schizophrenia, depression, anxiety, trauma issues, all are at higher risk for having gambling problems. So they're all high-risk groups, absolutely. And just for that reason, gambling acts like medication. It's a wonderful antidepressant. When I'm gambling, I don't feel depressed. When I'm gambling, I don't have panic attacks. Now, when I stop the gambling, I may feel more depressed and have more panic attacks, but it seems like a solution. People with schizophrenia don't hear voices when they're gambling. People with trauma issues don't have intrusive thoughts while they're gambling. So it seems like a wonderful solution for those mental health problems. So in all the previous DSMs, gambling was what I like to call on the island of misfit diagnoses. Impulse control disorders not elsewhere specified. So we were with kleptomania, pyromania, intermittent explosive disorder, hair pulling or trichotillomania, and gambling. Well, by the time we got to DSM-5, we finally had sufficient research evidence for everybody to accept that we need to be included with substance use disorders as an addiction. So the new category is substance-related and addictive disorders. Now, many people thought, okay, this, now we've got a real home, a place where we fit and belong. So insurance companies now will recognize us more legitimately, and state systems will recognize, you know, and this will happen automatically. Well, no, it's not automatic. We have to still fight with the insurance companies and convince them that it is an addiction and should be included with and reimbursed in the same ways as, you know, and included in state-funded programming and all of that. So there are still battles to be fought. the criteria remained much the same and very comparable to substance use criteria. So gambling with increasing amounts of money or time or other assets and valuable commodities in order to achieve the desired excitement, but not just excitement, the desired emotional mood state. So some people like the excitement, it's like cocaine for some folks. For other folks, it's like heroin, particularly people who play things like the slot machines or scratch-offs. I don't get excited. I just kind of zone out and numb out and feel oblivious, and I don't have to feel anything when I'm gambling. So for different people, different types of gambling have different mood-altering effects. And also, it's not always increasing amounts of money, because when I start out my career gambling, I may have lots of money. By the time, you know, I'm at the end of the career, I've got $2, and I haven't eaten in 48 hours, and I go buy a couple of lottery tickets rather than a burger. So it may be in taking increasing risks with the amount of money you have available, or wanting to spend more and more time in that activity. So many slots players go from playing, you know, the $5, the $20 slots to playing the penny slots just to make their money last longer and stay with their machine as long as possible. So tolerance can be developed in a lot of different ways. Restless, irritable, withdrawal symptoms. And it goes beyond that, but it's much more variable. Some people I've known have had dry heaves for a week when they stop gambling. Some people get very cognitively confused, agitated, can look like a psychosis almost when they stop gambling. A lot of agitation, sleeplessness, headaches, body aches. Gambling is also a wonderful pain reliever. People with chronic pain do not hurt when they're gambling. So the pain comes back. So you can have a whole range of physiological as well as emotional withdrawal symptoms. Loss of control, lots of ways to try to control, cut back, limit the gambling that haven't worked. Preoccupied, reliving past gambling experiences, whether you won or lost, reliving those experiences. Planning, strategizing, how am I going to do it, developing a system, this time it's going to work. How do I get money to gamble? So thinking not just about the gambling, but how I'm going to pay off my debts, how I'm going to get the money, lots of preoccupation. Gambling to relieve uncomfortable moods, to avoid feeling, to avoid stressors. Great stress reduction. I don't think about anything. One of my friends talks about it like the old Calgon commercial, if you're old enough to remember that. The woman, the young mother's in the kitchen, you know, and the pots are boiling over, and one kid's pulling on her dress, and the baby's in the high chair throwing food all over the place. The dog's pulling garbage out of the garbage can. The doorbell's ringing, and she's on the phone. And she says, oh, and there are pots boiling over on the stove. She says, Calgon, take me away, and she's whisked into the bathroom with the bathtub and the bubbles and the little rose bud in the vase and the doors closed, and she no longer cares what's going on in the kitchen. You know, she's in her place, and that's what my friend describes as her first time at a slot machine. All the problems, all the stressors went away. It was just me and my Calgon bath, not a care in the world. So it takes away those uncomfortable feelings. Lying to family members, to friends, to creditors, to employers, the whole thing. And jeopardizing all those negative consequences, losing jobs, relationships, educational opportunities. Kids who take their college money, drop out of school, get a refund, use that for gambling or to pay off gambling debts, a very high-risk population. What is a gambler going to give up first, their family or their job? Absolutely. I've worked with gamblers who've had 9, 10 marriages and kept the same job for 30 or 40 years. The job is my source of income. I need that for my gambling. The family, after I take all their money, wants money from me. They want to take away from my gambling money. And gamblers' heads and thinking get so distorted that I've had clients say, you know, I might as well get divorced because then I'll have more money and time for my gambling. And there won't be anybody to interfere with that, nobody wanting money for food or rent or utilities. And this is particularly associated with gambling, the bailouts. Oh, and we missed the chasing. Going back to get even. Now, substance abusers may chase that first high, but with gambling, I'm chasing more a reality. I'm chasing the money. And they've got my money, and I have to win it back. And it really is as if the casino or the lottery had a box in their basement that said Lori, with all the money I lost in it, just waiting for me to win it back. Now, if I go to see a movie, even if it's a bad movie, I usually don't say, I want my money back. You've got my money. No, I paid, you know. But with gambling, people really think they have my money. It's not just the cost of recreation. And I really deserve to win it back, and I can win it back, and next time it's going to be different, and then I'll stop. But somebody with a gambling problem just can't stop even when they're ahead, and that's the dilemma. And bailouts, relying on other people. Whether it's a personal bailout, friends, family members, coworkers, or an institutional bailout like bankruptcy, or just getting one more credit card offer in the mail when you thought you couldn't get another credit card. And not better explained by a manic episode. Now, you can have both, and I have a lot of bipolar folks who also have a gambling disorder. It is a rarity to have somebody who gambles only while they're in a manic episode. I've seen maybe a few of those over my whole career. Many more people who are misdiagnosed as bipolar who really just have a gambling problem, because providers ask about the mood swings. They don't ask about the gambling. All right. New specifiers, episodic or persistent, so you can be a binge gambler. It doesn't have to be continuous. Early remission and severity ratings. We didn't have that before DSM-5. And if you meet 4 of those criteria, you win. You've got a gambling problem. Differential diagnosis, professional gambling. There are some professional gamblers. They are a high-risk population. It takes a lot of discipline to be a professional gambler. You keep records. You pay your taxes. You know when to cut your losses. You don't start into chasing. Very, very few, and they usually make a reasonable, not an extravagant living, necessarily. This is a hard job. And to not get out of control. And we talked about the manic episode, and you can't have both. You can have a personality disorder. You can have an antisocial personality and have a gambling disorder. That could be very high risk for you if you're engaged in criminal activities. I've had clients, one guy who was really a hitman for organized crime. His gambling became a liability, and they were after him. He first came into treatment to hide out from the boys, you know. And this was when I was at a VA. And a couple years later, I got a call from a VA, I think it was in Atlanta. And he'd gotten the crap beat out of him. And he was in intensive care, and he'd been unconscious. And when he became conscious, he said, I want to go back to Brecksville, because they caught up with him. And they beat him because his gambling made him a liability to their efforts. and he might be, you know, willing to sell some of his secrets to pay off his gambling debts. Another guy who was in witness protection plan, and the FBI was using him to do stings through gambling. Now, he had a gambling problem, but they were making him gamble to tape record and find out about other illegal money laundering, and every time they made him do a sting, he would relapse on his own gambling. So he had antisocial personality, but he also had a gambling disorder. And you have to treat them both separately. Medical conditions, dopaminergic medications. Anybody know about the connection between Parkinson's disorder or restless leg syndrome and problem gambling? It's the medications that stimulate the dopamine system that precipitate a whole range of disinhibited behaviors, one of which can be gambling. Sexual behaviors can be another. So it's some of the newer medications for Parkinson's, Requip and Mirapex, that really seem connected to gambling. For some people, it's really obvious. You start the medication, the gambling gets out of control. You work with the neurologist and change the medications, and the gambling goes away. It's really kind of amazing. And you can't do anything else if you don't change the medications. All the behavioral interventions just do not work. It's really quite remarkable. For other people, especially those who have family history of addictive disorders, not so simple. The medications may aggravate the problem, but you may have to treat both. Decrease, change the medications, but still keep the person in some sort of treatment for the gambling disorder, even if you manage the medications. So, looking at substance use disorders and gambling, we talked about how many of the diagnostic criteria are the same, but what do you notice? You're right off the bat, when you look at these lists, and you need 4 out of 9 and 2 out of 11. You need to be twice as sick, which means I need to be twice as sick to get my insurance company to reimburse. I need to be twice as sick to get states to recognize that you need treatment for this disorder and be admitted to a treatment program. I need to be twice as sick to be counted in prevalence studies. So when we look at those prevalence rates and the fact that, you know, it may be less than substance use disorders, the bar is higher. If we had, and the reason this happened is because when they made DSM-5, they put together the substance abuse and the substance dependence categories. Since gambling didn't have that comparable category, they started at the higher benchmark. So this is our next battle for the next DSM, to make that comparable so we can get people into treatment before they're absolutely crashing and burning, you know, just like you can for substance use disorders. Some of the other differences is, you know, I've never met an alcoholic who said, if I could just have one more drink, my fortune would be made. It would solve all my problems. One more drink might help me forget my problems, but it's not going to solve them. With gambling, there's a kernel of reality that the next bet could do it. It could be the big one. And if I didn't gamble it all away again, it would solve a whole bunch of my problems. You know, I could send the kids to Harvard. I could, you know, buy the home for my family. I could quit my job. I could do what I wanted to do. And that fantasy has an element of reality to it. So there's a seduction to gambling that's just a little bit different than that for substance use disorders. You know, another issue is there aren't any biological tests. You know, you don't say, here's a cup and I'll see the dice come out. Ouch. You know, that doesn't happen. So you're not seeing any telltale signs. It's not, you can't smell it on the breath. The the pupils aren't dilated, my speech isn't slurred, I'm not staggering. So if I get stopped for erratic driving on my way home from the casino because I've been gambling for 72 hours straight without sleeping, you know, I'm not going to show any of those telltale signs, and I'm not going to get a DUI if I haven't been drinking at the casino. So I'll go on my merry way. Say, oh, I must have been just a little, okay, drive safe the rest of the way home. In 30 years, I've gotten one referral for driving under the influence of gambling only. Because the person said I was at the casino and I was gambling and I wasn't sleeping, and they referred him. They busted him. But we don't have laws for that necessarily. A lot of car accidents around casinos for this very reason, as well as that somebody's so depressed when they leave the casino, one of the fantasies is, well, I'll just run into the concrete abutment, and then my family can collect on the insurance, and I'm worth more alive, dead than I am alive. So a lot of those dissimilarities as well as the similarities. The other thing, there's no limit. Gambling is not self-limiting. There's only so much of a substance I can take before it kills me, I pass out, or more just doesn't have any more effect, I'm saturated. Gambling, as long as I can keep the money coming, it's like the Energizer Bunny. I can just keep going and going and going, and the high can keep getting higher and higher and higher. And I don't, you know, have any stops. That's why the debt, if you're a problem gambler, can be astronomical. There is no way you can drink or take enough of any drug to create the kind of financial dilemmas that some gamblers have. Now, for other gamblers, particularly folks who may come in, especially through state-funded programs with mental health or substance use disorders, it's not about the debt. It's about, I never got any money anyway, so why not gamble? You know, that's the only way I ever get a little extra money, by playing the numbers. You know, that's how when I was a kid, Mom paid off the rent. We had the house games. That was our solution. So if you start talking about problem gambling, there's a disconnect, because gambling is our solution. It's not the problem. So I think with many populations that are at risk for having the highest rates of problems, talking of problem gambling doesn't compute. The highest rates of gambling problems around the world, in every community, every culture, are among the group in that community, in that culture, that is the most marginalized socially and economically. So the poorest with the fewest advantages are going to have the highest rates of gambling problems, because it is the only way out that people see. So in the U.S., in many communities, it's African Americans. In some, it's Native Americans. In some communities, it's Asian Americans. In New Zealand, it's the Maori. In Canada, it's indigenous peoples. It can be new immigrants, because gambling is a part of every culture, and it's a way of staying connected to cultural traditions. We started out talking about it being a regressive tax. You know, and even though when you look at African-American gambling patterns, the percentage of adults in African-American communities who gamble is lower than in Caucasian. They gamble less, but have higher rates of gambling problems. That's how powerful it is as that source of hope out of this, you know, minimum wage job. A way out, if I've been incarcerated and have a felony conviction and can't get a good job, So a lot of issues around gambling as a public health issue that we just don't talk enough about. And it is our civic responsibility. You know, I have this kind of Orwellian notion that if I don't buy my lottery ticket, my neighbors gang up on me and turn me in for not paying my fair share of the taxes. You know, because we've gotten to the point where tax is a bad word, so how can we get government revenues? And the one thing about casinos that we know for sure is they increase state revenues. The problem is that even though they increase state revenues, people don't want to pay taxes. So a study was done years and years ago about lotteries and that money going to schools and looking at states that had lotteries versus states that didn't. And the lottery states overall spent less per capita per student on education than the states without lotteries, because people think, well, I'm not going to vote for that levy or that tax because that's what the lottery is supposed to be doing. It doesn't have to come out of my pocket. Now, I talked to my lottery about, you know what you need to do in terms of your advertising is figure out how to get more rich people to buy lottery tickets. And can't you make it a tax deduction? You know, it should be a tax deduction in some way. We got to figure out how to get the 1% to buy their fair share of lottery tickets. Oh, well, enough of that soapbox.
Can I go back one?
Sure.
Did I hear you say that the most marginalized impoverished group has the highest
rates
of the problem disorder,
yes,
but actually less gambling behavior?
Yeah.
So they're going to obsess about it and think about
it? In many African American communities, the spiritual perspective is that you shouldn't gamble. So you can understand the lower rates.
Yeah.
And even though maybe only 65% of adults might gamble, out of that 65%, you have a very high percentage who have gambling problems.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've heard that in Atlantic City, when they put the casinos in, the crime rate shot up because people were stealing money to gamble.
Well, that's a whole debate when you look at crime. Because what people will contend is, well, that's because you have more tourists and more visitors and more people coming into the area. And that's why the crime rate goes up. So one group did a study, and there's not a whole lot of research on most of these things because we don't keep the data. Studied two tourist destinations, Orlando, where there is no legalized gambling in the area, and Las Vegas. And the crime rate was higher in Las Vegas. So gambling seems to add an element to the crime rate, but folks on the industry side debate that hotly. Of course, you know. And you know, we have a great deal of data on the benefit, economic benefit of gambling. We have, they pay their taxes, employment, all that good kind of stuff. We don't collect any data on the downside. We don't know how many bankruptcies are filed as a result of gambling. We don't know how many divorces. We don't know how many suicides. We don't know how many car crashes because nobody's collecting the data. So there's that imbalance of how do we make public health decisions with limited and imperfect data, and we need to get better at collecting that data. All right. This was an Ohio study. They looked at folks in substance abuse treatment and found that 27% gambled more when they were using alcohol or drugs. About 17% used more alcohol or drugs when they were gambling. And about 16% gambled in order to buy alcohol or drugs. And they probably also sold drugs in order to get money for their gambling, and it becomes circular. So there's that interconnectedness of the addictive disorders.
Can we take a break?
Sure. Why don't we take a break? 5 minutes. Okay, let's get back on track here. You guys are great. I love the interaction and the questions. I need my mindfulness bell.
Yeah.
So when we're looking at folks with substance use and mental health disorders, we see consistently high rates with substance use. You know, gambling can be a disorder in and of itself, a co-occurring disorder. It can be a sequential addiction. I stop my alcohol use, my drug use, and then I get into gambling. Or it can be a relapse risk factor. It may not be a problem in and of itself, but if I go to the casino, what do they offer? Free drinks. Or I win. You know, yeah, and I want to celebrate. And there's a much higher risk of substance use relapse behind winning than there is behind losing. So, you know, winning is much more problematic if you're gambling. And having a big win early on in your career is a risk factor. So it's always better if you have kids if they lose when they start off gambling than if they win. But also, with folks, one study with folks with serious mental health disorders found that the gambling was associated in that group with also higher rates of depression, more alcohol use problems, more legal problems, and greater utilization of treatment services. And this was associated with that recreational kind of at-risk group as much as the group identified as problem gamblers. Now, this is a lovely piece of information, that very large national comorbidity survey. Half of the people who had a lifetime pathological gambling diagnosis received mental health or substance use services. None, zero, zip, in that very large study had gotten any help for their gambling disorder. So folks dealing with gambling problems are already in our systems, already in our practices, already in all of our programs. But it's really been a don't ask, don't tell policy. They don't bring it up, we don't bring it up, and we don't have the conversation. Per DSM, gambling is associated with poor general health as well. And again, a very large national epidemiological survey, they defined at-risk gambling as 5 times a year or more. I would qualify, especially when Powerball or Mega Millions gets to the point where Mega Millions is, you know, 200 million is my limit. Once it's there, I buy my ticket. You know, but that's what they defined as at risk. And even that moderate amount of gambling was associated with increased medical utilization and healthcare costs. People who had cardiovascular problems at higher rates, emergency room, expensive treatment, experienced severe injury, obesity, and psychiatric problems, substance use problems. And that group was 25% of the population. So we go from 1% to 3% to 25%, where gambling is associated with increased health care costs, especially if it goes unaddressed. Domestic violence, right? 10 times as likely if the partner has a gambling problem, 6 times as likely if the partner had a drinking problem, 50 times as likely if you have both. And what do the police ask about when they come for domestic violence? You've been drinking, using any drugs? Nobody asks about gambling. But high correlations, very volatile situations if you try to get in between a gambler and his or her money. Or if you decide I need to confess how much I've lost or how much of our money is gone. Very dangerous situations. Gamblers, folks with gambling problems who were perpetrators or victims of violence, and severe child abuse. Child neglect And we've had several cases in Maryland of kids being left in cars. And when you go gambling, it's very dissociative. I'm only going to go in for an hour. The kids will be fine. They've got their juice packets. They've got their games. Nothing to worry about. You know, 4, 5, 6, 7 hours later, in the summer, in the sun, and the baby is dead in the car. Yeah. Oh, it happens constantly. It just happened with a four-year-old in Maryland. I used to work for a group, and we managed an intensive outpatient gambling program in Las Vegas. So I ended up going there more times than I ever wanted to in my wildest dreams. But of course, stay at a casino hotel, walk through the parking lot, and I can't tell you how often I would see the kids set up in the car. And these were not air-conditioned parking lots in Las Vegas in the summer. You know, but you'd call up security, and they were very good because they didn't want dead kids found in the parking lot at their casino. But very, very common situation. Elder abuse and elder neglect. You know, I'm supposed to be watching my parent or managing their money. And a lot of embezzling, not necessarily by family members, but by health care providers for the elderly. And when a gambler, a person with a gambling problem, takes this money, it doesn't compute that it's stealing, because I'm not really taking it to spend it. I'm taking it to gamble, and I'm going to win, and then I will pay it back. So it's not really for me. I'm just borrowing it to get out of this jam. So they don't even believe they're doing something illegal. And when they get busted, you know, it's like this huge light. Oh, my God, what have I done? And it all comes crashing in. And I think that's why the suicide rate is really high. About 20% of folks seeking treatment for a gambling disorder have made a significant suicide attempt. Because when it ends hard and deep. The good news is, and in your packets, there are a bunch of these screens, brief screens, 2 questions, 3 questions, 4 questions. So when the research started developing these screens, we were really excited. All you have to do is give all your clients these screens, and you're going to find all these people with gambling problems. Woo-hoo! The lie bet. Have you ever felt the need to bet more and more? The chasing question, or the tolerance question, and have you ever lied about your gambling? The NODS was an instrument used for the last national prevalence study in 1999. Loss of control, lying, and preoccupation. The PERC, another subset from that work. Preoccupation, the relief from distressing feelings, chasing, and negative consequences. All of those in the research work really well. If you use these in substance use disorder populations, you'll get 30 to 50% responding positively. So that sounds really exciting, to help identify folks with potential problems. Well, the bad news is that the screens don't work for diddly squat in actual clinical practice. My buddy and I, when the lie bet first came out, we were working with the state of Illinois. And we said, now we've got 2 questions. You just put those in your screens, and you're going to find these people. And we did the training, and we went back to our office. We thought the phone would ring. And we were like the Maytag repairman. We waited, and we waited, and no phone calls, and the cobwebs started growing over. So we went back and did the second round of training. Well, you didn't call us, but you probably knew what to do. How many did you get? None. Nobody answers yes to this question. So in our infinite wisdom, we said, well, you must be doing something wrong. You know, 28 years later, it's not that they were necessarily doing anything wrong. The questions don't work. In research, what do I say? This is going to be confidential. It's just our little secret. I'm not going to tell anybody. I'm not going to tell your probation officer. I'm not going to tell your counselor. You're not going to have to go to more treatment, get another group, go to another 12-step program. So people feel okay being honest. You know, in treatment, there's no way I'm going to cop to another problem, even if I know what you're talking about. Okay? Because what those screens do is what we talked about early on. They don't define gambling. They just go in and ask this lovely question like, oh, are you a liar? Do you lie about gambling? Now, who's going to say yes to that in that initial screening where you've already asked me every imaginable intrusive question under the sun, you know, and it's Friday afternoon and this is, you know, the end of an hour and a half grilling? You know, it just doesn't work that way. And one study done in Iowa shows exactly that. They used the lie bet and they thought, well, maybe it's just the lie bet that doesn't work. So they tried another one. And the most you get maybe 1 to 3%, and those are just people who are probably too disoriented to know what they were saying.
You're just so tired.
You know, and that compares in Maryland. We just finished this study in outpatient substance use and found 40% who met DSM-5 criteria for a gambling disorder in outpatient substance use treatment, and not just mild problems, moderate to severe problems. So they were answering a number of DSM questions positive. But when you looked at the clinical data, only 2.5% of those clients were saying they had any gambling issues. So there's a real disconnect there, and we're actually following up with some of these folks and doing structured interviews and focus groups to really understand better what their gambling is about. Maybe they really don't have any gambling problems, or why they aren't talking about them in substance use treatment, and nobody's ever done that work. They've done the research that says you've got 40%, but nobody's ever looked at, well, why aren't they showing up in treatment? So we're trying to sort that out. So what happens is people use the screen, nobody says yes, so the counselors and the agency think, well, none of our clients have a problem. I don't care what the research says, not in my treatment program. So I don't have to deal with it and everybody's happy. Besides, I put in your screening questions, I have done what you asked me to do. What more do you want me to do? I've done my job. Case closed. You know, so it's like sometimes doing something is worse than doing nothing. And I think this is one of those cases. Individuals coming in for treatment for a substance use or mental health problem may never have even thought of gambling as a problem or a potential problem. So they're pre-contemplated. Or as we talked about, they see it as the solution to their problems, not a problem in and of itself. They may realize it's a problem, but I don't want to give up all my fun. You told me I should stop smoking, I shouldn't be drinking caffeine, I have to change my eating patterns, and I probably shouldn't have sex in the first year of recovery, and you want me to give up what else? You know, give me a break, just, you know, take me now, give me the pine box. Or they're so overwhelmed. Look, it's all I can do to deal with this alcohol or this drug issue. Don't make me think about anything else. So all or some subset of those may be going on with our clients. What we really also have looked at is what keeps people from getting help. And some preliminary research in talking about folks with gambling problems who haven't asked for help is, I want to solve this on my own. I know I can figure it out. I just need to tweak my system a little bit, and then I'll get it. And it's very shameful. Most people understand if I put a toxic chemical in my brain, it changes my behavior, my thinking. And most of us, even if we don't have a substance use problem, have had some experience with taking a medication that changes our perception. I take some cough medicine and I'm high as a kite, you know, or I take pain medication and I get a little woozy and I can't think straight. So we know what it does, and we have an understanding of how that affects my ability to think clearly and function. Not true for gambling. Most people who gamble, it doesn't really affect their cognition the way it does if you develop a gambling problem. So even somebody with a gambling disorder, it's just me. I'm not changing my brain, you know. I'm just doing something. You know, it's not as if I were drinking or taking drugs. That I could understand why it changed my behavior. So people don't get that gambling changes brain functioning and hijacks the brain the same way substances do.
The parallel for me is the difference between the way we view physical illness and mental illness. Physical illness, you can see it. It shows up on a test.
Yeah.
You can see the cast, whatever.
Right.
Mental illness.
Yeah.
To us, you can see it on a test, but to the average person.
Right.
So the same thing here. It's like.
So it's not the drugs or the alcohol making me do this. It's just me. And there must be something really, really wrong with me that I keep doing these terrible, awful, rotten things to myself and to people I care about. You know, if I'm a drinker, I might ruin my liver, but it doesn't ruin my spouse's or my kid's liver. If I'm a gambler, I ruin everybody's finances, often for the rest of their lives. You know, my spouse can't retire, has to go back to work, has a bad credit rating, can't get a loan. You know, all of those things. My kids can't go to college, which affects the rest of their lives. So the impact on families can be very, very long-lasting. And the anger is just so intense compared to substance use. So the shame and the embarrassment, reluctance to admit the problem, especially in some cultures like Asian American cultures, where gambling is so much a part of the culture and everybody's expected to be able to do it, and losing control is such a pride issue that it's very, very shameful. And just too overwhelmed to get help. Service center factors is, I told somebody about this. I told my doc about this. I told my substance use counselor about this. And they didn't get it. And I felt even more shameful, like it really was me. So they had a bad experience and felt like even more of a failure, more of a screw up. I went to treatment, and the treatment was in the substance use program. And people who come into treatment for a gambling disorder are a very different demographic often than people come into treatment for a substance use disorder. So they treated me like an addict. They were in my face. They did not treat me respectfully. They didn't meet me where I was at. I was out of there. I'm not one of those people. Or I went to the mental health center, and there were people there talking to themselves, and they looked kind of different. And I'm not crazy. I'm not crazy like those people. So where do I fit? You know, at one program, we developed a separate interest for our gambling clients so they wouldn't feel like they didn't fit. Now, you don't want to play into the I'm better than, but you got to get them into treatment first, you know. And that can be challenging and problematic. Or I couldn't get it at the time and place I wanted. You know, our state-funded programs and our substance use programs are like, you know, you got to be here so I don't have to be nice to you. You got to come in for your assessment when I say you come in. You come in and you show up and you wait, and maybe you'll get an assessment today. And that is really true of some substance use settings. You wait, and if you don't get it done today, you come back tomorrow. It's not like you got a job, right? You're just a druggie. You can't treat gamblers that way. They don't have to be there. They'll call their congressperson and complain. You know? Little bit of a sense of entitlement, but we can work on that if you can get into treatment. So you have to set up services often a little bit differently than the infrastructure is familiar with. And not that it's right that we do that to folks with substance use or mental health disorders. That's just the reality. And they should all be treated in a much more respectful, person-centered kind of way. So, whole nother soapbox. Well, in Connecticut, we wanted to get everything. We were allowed one question in the screening. We wanted to get everything into that one question, so we created this absolutely impossible question. Have you ever borrowed money to gamble? Gamble more than you intended to, or lied about how much you gambled? Have you or someone else ever thought gambling might be causing problems in your life? That is an unanswerable question. You know, so you have to watch out how you format these things. Yeah.
Why are all the screens so obviously pathological, unlike, say, the audit?
Yes, absolutely. That's another wonderful point. They start out by asking the tip of the iceberg questions. Because,
it wouldn't be hard to do something like the audit.
Yeah. Well, you know, when you're, you know, a system says, okay, we'll put in your gambling screening questions. What do you have that's evidence-based? That's what we got. Because in the research, they wanted to see who was diagnosable as having a gambling problem. So they started out with the diagnostic questions, and you're right. It's a turnoff. You'll start people being defensive, and it won't apply to many people, or at least they won't think it applies. And the strategy to use is exactly what you're talking about. So the questions, the way they're asked, as well as the way the counselor asks, and I can't tell you, we'll get back to your point in a second. How many counselors have told me exactly this? Well, I can save time on these gambling questions. That's not why she's here anyway. You don't have any gambling problems, do you? And they say, this is how I've asked it. Never occurred to me that I was asking it and giving them the answer. And everybody's happy. We can go home. No other issues. So counselors really need to understand and get training in the overall picture, know what the impact of gambling is on their clients' recovery, and know they have the tools to help. Again, I've had treatment program administrators as well as counselors say, if we ask the questions and we get a yes, then we have to do something about it or we'll get dinged. And if we don't ask, that solves the problem. And they're right. Because note, the reviewers for Jayco or CARF don't say, well, you're not asking gambling questions. They don't care. But if somebody says, I have a gambling problem, then you have to address it. And we don't know how to do that. So you really have to work with folks to ask the questions and to know what to do with it if they get a yes response that isn't, again, overwhelming to overtask agencies and providers. General practitioners in one study just says, well, it's just really inappropriate if I ask somebody about gambling out of the blue. I've gotten used to asking about their drinking. You know, isn't that bad enough? And now you want to ask. So you really have to work with folks to feel comfortable and to know how to handle it if the client comes back and say, well, what are you asking about my gambling for? You need to know how to respond to them. So first, you define gambling. You know, next I'm going to ask you a few questions about gambling. For example, I mean buying lottery tickets, playing cards, you know, and those common forms of gambling, so we're on the same page. You know, well, I don't really gamble, but I do buy lottery tickets, you know, a few times a week, and occasionally my friends and I go to the casino. So it opens the door without the person having to be defensive about immediately being labeled as having a problem. So one of our strategies, kind of a gambling SBIRT, a gambling brief intervention and referral to treatment process. first define gambling, then ask a less pejorative question like, tell me a bit about your gambling. How often have you gambled in the last year? That's like saying, do you ever have a glass of wine with dinner? It's not quite as, you know, off-putting as, are you a liar? You know, and then if somebody says five times a year or more, which was the evidence-based criteria in that one very large study, because we don't even know what exactly is normative. So we don't have data on what does the average person drink per week or per day. This is about the best that we have. One other study, I called the guy who did a large prevalence study, and he said his median was about once a month for an adult population. So those are about the two best data points we have. And if somebody says I gamble five times a year or more, then you can go on to the nasty questions, the more diagnostic-based questions. And then the rest of the diagnostic criteria. So we really have to train counselors about asking these questions and how to respond in a way that they're not jumping on people who say yes to any of these questions, but just keeping the conversation alive. You know, and allowing that conversation to unfold. So if somebody says yes, you can start giving them some feedback, tell them a little bit about the levels of gambling we talked about, some risk factors, and then the process for reducing the harm gambling may cause in their life, guidelines for safe, low-risk, responsible gambling. Nancy Petrie in Connecticut is one of the few researchers who looked at this, and you can do it in about 10 or 15 minutes. Doesn't have to take much time. Feedback, whoop, you're in this little narrow slice of folks who may have gambling problems. What do you think about that? Here's how it might go ideally. I can see from your response you are being really honest and open. That shows you're motivated to really work on your recovery. Some of your responses about gambling suggest you may have, that gambling may have some negative effect on your recovery. I'd like to give you some feedback and information. Is that okay with you? I always like asking permission from clients. The client, well, yeah, I guess that's okay. I never really thought much about my gambling. My drinking seems to be what always gets me into trouble. That's great. I appreciate your willingness to talk about something you really haven't even thought about before and its effect on your recovery. Tell me about your gambling and how you think it fits into your life and into your recovery. Well, I play cards with my buddies. We've been doing this for years. We do drink at the games. I hadn't thought about that. Do you think that's a problem? Affirmation, that's a great connection. I think that might be something for you to think about. Remember, it was pre-contemplative a second ago. You're not going to jump from that into action. So that's something for you to think about. One way we can look at the card playing is to look at the pros and the cons. Is that something you'd be willing to do? And then we do a cost-benefit analysis. Gambling benefits, how important is that? Gambling costs, how much distress? So our mythical client says, well, I like playing cards, it's fun, I relax, I like the camaraderie, and I often win a little bit of money. The cost, well, I drink at the games, my wife seems to get upset at the time away and when I come home drunk, and sometimes I borrow money. You did a great job of really looking clearly at the things you enjoy about the gambling and some of the downside. What do you make of that? I don't draw any judgments. I ask what the client thinks. Yeah, I think I can see what you're getting at. Gambling is fun, but it always seems to lead to drinking. I know how drinking is messing me up. I never connected it with my card playing. It's really good that you're able to see both sides. You do have fun. That double-sided reflecting the ambivalence. But you can also see how it interferes with your goal of not drinking. Yeah, I always thought it was just something fun. didn't realize the connection. You can talk then, yeah.
So that fits in with identifying persons, places, and things.
Absolutely. It's what we always do. We haven't specifically focused on gambling or asked the gambling questions necessarily. And gambling can be one of those places that's very slippery for folks with a substance use disorder. Whether it's smoking or drinking or drugs, I mean, those things tend to be around gambling. We have this little card that we have available, a wallet-sized card that says, has low risk and high risk gambling on one side, and then how to keep it safe on the other side with where to get help if you can't do that. So you can give somebody that feedback. What we're really working on with working with whole agencies is addressing gambling and gambling problems for individuals with primary substance use or mental health is not just about finding people who fit the diagnosis or finding cases. That's how I started out. I wanted you to screen to find my cases for me. I've gotten beyond my selfishness a little bit, realized it wasn't really productive, but looking and making sure that the impact of gambling on mental health and substance use recovery is a topic of conversation. In doing the screening, I don't even care how people answer the questions anymore. I just want people to begin thinking, how is this connected to my life? And what role do I want it to play? So we do a sneakier approach. We work with agencies to put gambling into all of these sections in their assessment and connected. For example, medical problems. Do you take your medication the way you're supposed to? Well, not always. Well, what gets in the way? Can you afford your medication? Well, it's really hard. What do you do to try to pay for your medication? Or what gets in the way of you affording your medication? Oh, we talked about chronic pain. What do you do to feel better? Do you rest? Do you exercise? Do you take medicine? Or do you do some activities like gambling help you not feel the pain? So there are ways you can connect it to medical problems. Certainly the financial piece is a wonderful entry. Do you have any financial problems? How do you try to solve them? What creates those problems? Do you argue with family members about money? Does gambling ever come into those arguments? Family history, easy. Not rocket science. Do you have a family history of any substance use problems, any mental health problems, any gambling problems? Doesn't have to add pages to the assessment. If you've had periods of abstinence before, what did you do when you weren't drinking or using drugs? Did you start eating more? Did you engage in more problematic sexual behaviors? Did you start gambling more? Ever had any treatment for mental health, substance use, or gambling problems? You know, it's obvious once you start thinking in that context. We talked about depression. What helps you feel less depressed? You know, gambling, bike riding, crocheting, what? And what do you do for fun? You know, do you go to play bingo at your church? Do you ever go to the casino? Just include it. Just mention it. And not taking a lot of time to try to push people to talk about it. Just start seeing the connection. The key is to raise the issue in multiple contexts repeatedly over time. So in the screening, in the intake, in the assessment. Mention it in your psychoeducational classes. Whatever you talk about, the biology of addiction, talk about how alcohol, drugs, and gambling affect the brain. You know, gambling has an impact, and there are genetic factors to being at risk for gambling that have to do with frontal lobe deficits. You know, and gambling, as you gamble more and more, gets into the automatic habitual kinds of behaviors that you see with substance abuse that bypass our frontal lobes. trauma issues that have to do with one of the symptoms of foreshortened view of the future. I don't anticipate the future. So somebody who has trauma issues has damage to a part of the frontal lobes that has to do with planning for the future. I don't see a future. So kids who've grown up in traumatic communities like our inner cities are not likely to be able to plan for the future. Gambling is perfect. Yeah.
You know, I work with kids that have said that, like, what do you want to do when you grow up? And they say, well, I'm going to be dead.
Right.
And I never really thought, why? Is that like a very intense defense mechanism, and how can you change it?
It's probably all of the above, but don't neglect the fact that their brains just aren't structured to think that way.
Because of the trauma that they've experienced.
Because of the trauma really affects brain circuits and that part of the brain that's able to plan for the future.
The future is to...
And also, the you know, there's a reality to that. I'm going to be in jail or I'm going to be dead. That's reality. But also, I can't imagine a different future. And part of that is because my brain needs to develop that area that can even imagine that. So there are so many factors working against kids.
So will they be subconsciously, you know, fulfilling that goal? You know, I'll do this because I'm not going to be around anyway. Almost like a death wish, taking risks.
Well, it gives me a sense of control.
Okay.
Like gambling, you know, gives me this illusion of control. If I am depressed and my emotions feel uncontrollable, when I gamble, I'm happy when I win, and I'm depressed when I lose. At least I have some degree of control over that. One of my clients said, you know I used to call you when I lost gambling and say, I feel so bad, I feel like sticking a knife in my stomach. But now that I'm not gambling, the depression is so much worse because I don't have control over it. So it helped push those demons away, and gambling seemed to control it. So I think, you know, being in a gang, taking charge of my life, whatever way that is, it's the only way I can at the moment. Mm-hmm. And that at least gives me more hope than feeling totally out of control in a world that is unmanageable. So it's not a death wish, it's a coping wish.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm only coping in the only way I see possible. And I think it's coming at this from a perspective of our clients, no matter how screwed up their behavior seems, that's the best thing they can do in this moment to get through.
Yeah.
If they could do anything different or any better, they would. You know, so I'm always doing the best I can in any given moment. And our job is just to help people develop their brains and their skills to think there is something else that won't be as harmful and may give me the benefits that I'm really looking for. Yeah?
Are you going to drug medication like SSRIs?
I can, and there's no specific medication particularly for problem gambling. SSRIs are used, and it's a case by case. They certainly help with the co-occurring issues like depression and anxiety. In some cases, they seem to help with cravings. The only medication may be naltrexone that has been shown to work for gambling cravings, but it works best in only that group that had the most severe cravings ongoingly, and it has some toxicity effects, and they had to use it at fairly high levels. So not for your ordinary run-of-the-mill gambler necessarily. Folks are looking at things like some medications that are used for Alzheimer's that seem to help some frontal lobe judgment, structuring, kind of cognitive flexibility issues, as well as some dietary supplements. N-acetylcysteine, you know, may work for smoking, and you know, so a lot of research is being done, but nothing really definitive. It's mostly for the co-occurring issues rather than specifically for the gambling. And for issues like impulsiveness that may underlie a whole range of behaviors. Charles is one case. He was a guy in a methadone maintenance treatment, 34, had been abstinent for opiates on methadone, but says, now I'm having these cocaine cravings, and I got the money that I had been spending on the heroin, so I got this $100. I'm having cocaine cravings, so I'm going out and buying $100 worth of lottery tickets. Isn't that better than scoring the cocaine? What do you say to that? I said, yes, I'm glad you're thinking about reducing the harm in your life. And you're right, you're not going to get busted for buying the lottery tickets. You're not going to end up in jail. It may not have the same effect on your health. But do you see any problems with that, or have you thought about other ways you might spend that $100, you know, to enjoy yourself? And he said, well, you know, there is some child support. And I said, well, you know, let's think about this, because paying child support isn't necessarily as much fun as buying lottery tickets. So, you know, and the more I told him just to think about it, the more he started talking about how he really wants a relationship with his son and how this is important and what a good time he had, you know, last weekend when he spent some time with his son. So the lower key I was on the issue, the more room he had to talk about whether buying the lottery tickets was a good idea or whether there were some other things he might choose to do with that money. It was a very interesting conversation. But these are the kind of things that come up when you start talking about gambling with folks with substance use issues. And talking about, well, is this low risk? Is this high risk? One guy in a substance abuse program said, well, low-risk gambling are the dice games where nobody pulls a knife on me if I win. And I said, yeah. And I said, that's really, he goes, I don't go to those games where they pull the knives. I said, that's really good judgment. You know, are there any other ways that you see gambling, you know, might have a negative effect on your life, on your well-being? And you open the conversation, you know, so you start where the person is at. How is it helping your goals in life? How might it be taking away from those? And what are your personal guidelines? We work a lot with limited or controlled or harm reduction in the gambling field. It's not just an abstinence-based model. So we can engage people where they're ready to be engaged and work with them and monitor and see if they can stay within those limits, if their plan is working, and catch it early on and try something else to, so that they won't crash and burn. And I think that's particularly helpful when you're working with somebody who's come in for some other issue and hasn't even thought about the gambling issue. This was another woman, 57-year-old. Her grandson turned her in by talking about the fact that Granny occasionally smokes a little joint now and then. And the teacher turned them into Children's Protective Services. So she comes into treatment because she doesn't want to lose her relationship with her grandkids, and she's also living with them. And in the process, acknowledges that she plays bingo 4 or 5 times a week. She takes her 82-year-old mother to the bingo games, and it's a good way to get out of the house because she and her daughter are always butting heads. However, she spent $5,000 in the past 6 months on bingo. And if she's living with her daughter out of financial necessity, you have to kind of say, gee, is that something you want to look at? You know, and she wasn't real excited about looking at that. She wasn't really excited about being there for her marijuana use. So just slowly talk with her about those connections and what her goals in life are. And she really didn't want to be living with her daughter. So how do you think we can get there? And is gambling helping or not helping you reach that goal? And looking at defining these things real specifically for folks. How do you want to gamble? How don't you want to gamble? What are your goals? How is it helping you to meet those? And after looking at all that, you want to change what your goals are and how you want gambling to be a part of your life. And then you can contract how much time, how much money you'll spend gambling, the frequency, what are the low-risk activities, what are the high-risk activities, and halt. I won't gamble when I'm feeling angry or stressed or depressed or when I need money. You know, never gamble when you need money. And one of our slogans on our posters and billboards is only gamble what you can afford to lose. And then identify your warning signs. And what are you going to do if any of those warning signs crop up? What actions will you take? What will those trigger? Linda's another case study. Remember, even though these are high-risk folks, not for everybody does gambling have a negative impact. You know, even in the high-risk groups, the majority of those folks gamble without any significant problems. And you have to be open to that people can gamble without necessarily creating problems, and it might even be beneficial. It is a way I get out and socialize for older adults. It is a way for folks with mental health disorders that I feel part of a, you know, normalized culture. Some resources we have. These are where we have some of our ad campaigns. One of my favorites is Baltimore Dice Zombies that a youth group created for us. And we have a great music video at the Baltimore Gambler that some rap and hip-hop artists created for us. So check them out. This is where you can reach me. This is our website. So a lot of resources there if you want them. And thank you so very, very much for being here at the beginning of the holiday weekend.